Hello students, welcome back to my session. So in this session we will be dealing with another important experiment. So that is Davison and Germer experiment, so which gave another proof for the wave nature associated with the material particles which are in motion. So the experimental arrangement for this particular Davison and Germer experiment is as shown in the diagram. So it consists of a filament F, which is coated with the barium oxide. So when this filament is heated with a low tension battery, so this filament get heated up and they emit the electrons, and the electrons which are emitted by these particular filament that is coated with the barium oxide are accelerated towards the anode, so which is having a fine hole which is parallel to its axis of the cylinder. And this anode or the cylinder where the electrons are being attracted is being connected to a high tension battery, where with the help of this battery or high tension battery the electrons are being accelerated. So the electrons which are coming out of this particular anode or the cylinder will be a collimated beam of electrons. So these collimated beam of electrons are made to fall on the nickel target. Okay, so whenever this collimated beam of electrons are made to fall on this nickel target, now the electron beam is scattered in all the directions. Okay, now the electrons which are scattered by the nickel target are being detected by the detector which is connected to a sensitive galvanometer, and this detector can be moved or it can be movable on the graduated scale. Now the angle between the initial direction of the electron beam and this particular scattered beam can be taken as pi. Okay, so this is the scattering angle, so pi will be known as the scattering angle. Okay, now our intention is to prove that we have to show that whenever the electrons are being accelerated with a certain potential difference, so they are associated with the wave, that is they are associated with the waves. Okay, so that particular wavelength is given by lambda is equal to 12.27 divided by square root of v for the electron. Now by this experiment we have to show that the potential difference with which you are accelerating and the wavelength that you get correspondingly will be equal to the wavelength that is being obtained in this particular experiment. Okay, so now let us see how will this Davison and Germer experiment will show that there is a wave nature associated with the material particles. Now what we are going to do is basically we are going to measure the intensity of the scattered beam along the different directions. That is, see, I said whenever the electron which is coming, that is an electron beam which is coming out of the cylinder or the anode A, is made to fall on the nickel target. Now the electron beam is scattered in all possible directions, but in all possible directions we don't know what is the intensity. So this particular detector, which can be moved on a graduated scale, will measure the intensity of the scattered electron with respect to the scattering angle. Now if I plot a graph by taking or by measuring the variation of intensity of the scattered electron with the scattering angle is obtained for different voltages. Okay, if I substitute those particular values, okay, along in a graph, so we can see that there will be certain interpretations. So if we plot the variation of intensity of the scattered electron with the scattering angle pi, so then we can obtain there is for different accelerating voltages we'll obtain different graphs. So the different graphs can be shown here. So in this particular direction of the, there is angle made with the direction of the incident beam, and for different voltages if you go on plotting the intensity of the scattered electron, we'll get graphs like this. And the operating voltage for this particular Davison and Germer experiment is from 44 volt to 68 volt. Okay, so here we have shown very few number of graphs. So where we are getting a little bit pronounced pattern of diffraction. Okay, so here the operating voltage, as I said, it will be in between 44 volt to 68 volt. So here we have shown a graph for 44 volt and 48 volt, 54 volt, and for 60 volt and 68 volt. So here only for these particular values of voltage, or that is accelerating voltage, we are seeing some pronounced peaks. But exactly at 54 volt and for scattering angle of 50 degree, scattering angle of 50 degree, that is for pi is equal to 50 degree, and for operating voltage of 54 volt, we can see that there is a pronounced peak. See, observe the peak here. It is little bit pronounced when compared to this graph or this one or this one, right? So here the voltage for this particular pronounced peak is 54 volt operating voltage, and the angle of scattering is exactly pi is equal to 50 degree. Now, see, if I put this particular value of voltage at the formula 12.27 divided by square root of V, I'll get lambda as 1.65 angstrom. That is, if I substitute the value of V is equal to 54 volt in this particular equation, I'll get the de Broglie waves associated, that is the de Broglie wavelength associated with this electrons which is accelerated will be 1.65 angstrom. Now we have to show that from the experiment that the de Broglie wavelength associated with the electrons which are being accelerated by a certain potential difference will also be equal to 1.65 angstrom. Now let us consider the Bragg's law, that is 2d sine theta is equal to n lambda. So this is what we call it as the Bragg's law, as we have seen in our previous video. So Bragg's law is given by the equation 2d sine theta is equal to n lambda, where d is nothing but the interatomic planes distance. So that is, for nickel crystal, d will be equal to 0.91 angstrom. That is the distance between one plane of the nickel crystal, that is, and the other plane of the nickel crystal in an that is nickel atoms in a crystal will be equal to 0.91, or d is the distance of the atomic planes in a nickel crystal. It will be equal to 0.91 angstrom, and theta is what we call it as the glancing angle. Remember that here we have pi, so pi will be known as the scattering angle, but here theta is known as glancing angle. So now we have to calculate the glancing angle. Okay, so how to calculate the glancing angle? Let us have a look into it. See, here we have the nickel crystal like this. Okay, so this is the nickel target or the nickel crystal. So the electron beam is striking this particular plane of this nickel crystal, and it is being scattered in this direction. So the angle between the initial direction of the electron and this particular scattered beam is taken as the scattering angle pi. Now this angle, what you get, that is the angle between the plane of the nickel crystal and this electron beam, this is theta and this is theta. So here theta is known as the glancing angle. Okay, so that is the angle made with the surface. Okay, so from this we can see that, from the diagram we can see that this theta plus this scattering angle pi plus again this glancing angle theta is equal to 180 degree. Why? Because this is a straight line. So here we have 2 theta plus pi is equal to 180 degree. So therefore theta is equal to 180 degree, or 2 theta is equal to 180 degree minus pi, or we have theta is equal to 180 degree minus pi divided by 2. So theta will be equal to 180 degree minus, how much you got the peak for which scattering angle, that is pi is equal to 50 degree. So 50 degree divided by 2. So this is, theta will be equal to 130 degree divided by 2, which is equal to 65 degree. Got it? Hope we have understood there is theta, here is a glancing angle, so we got glancing angle as theta is equal to 65 degree. Now we have found out the value of glancing angle, that is theta, so we have theta is equal to 65 degree, and d, that is the interatomic distance in the nickel crystal, as 0.91 angstrom. And n is the order of diffraction. So if I take the first order diffraction, n is equal to 1. So if I substitute all these values in this, we get 2 into 0.91 into 10 to the power of minus 10 into sine of 65 degree. So which is equal to lambda, because n is equal to 1. So if I simplify this, I get lambda is equal to 0.165. nanometer, or lambda is equal to 1.65 into 10 to the power of minus 10 meter, which is lambda is equal to 1.65 angstrom. See, observe here. So how did you get this particular lambda as 1.65 angstrom? Means which we obtained from the Bragg's law, where we substituted theta is equal to 65 degree as a glancing angle. How did we get this 65 degree? Recall this particular equation, that is, while finding the glancing angle, you substituted the value of the scattering angle pi as 50 degree. Why? Because you got a pronounced peak at 50 degree from the graph. So where did you get this 50 degree? From the experiment, right? So if I substitute the value of this particular scattering angle as 50 degree, and if you calculate, or if you obtain the glancing angle theta, and if you substitute this glancing angle in this particular equation, okay, so then we got lambda as 1.65 angstrom. And similarly, with the help of the de Broglie waves associated with the material particle whenever it is been accelerated by a certain potential difference V, we have for electrons as 12.27 divided by square root of V. And for V is equal to 54 volt, we got the lambda value as 1.65. So the lambda that you have obtained theoretically and experimentally is one and the same, right? It is 1.65 angstrom and 1.65 angstrom, so which are in good agreement with each other. So these experiment, that is Davison and Germer experiment, again gave a proof that whenever any material particle is in motion, it will be definitely associated with the waves, or it will be a wave associated with the wave nature. So in case of G.P. Thomson experiment also, we have seen that the theoretical result and the experimental result are holding good. And in this particular Davison and Germer experiment also, we are able to see that that is, both are in good agreement with each other. So these two experiments proved that there is any material particle in motion, it will be definitely associated with certain waves. So that is what we call it as the experimental proof for the de Broglie hypothesis. Okay, so this is all about the two experiments. If you have any doubts, so please comment on the comment box. So meet you in the next video. Thank you.